Hi, folks. Welcome to another episode of NYC CNC. I have to say, you guys really blew me away. I was really excited to post the video on drawing out the copper jackets, but I had no idea there'd be such a positive response. Super excited to hear that you guys are really interested in seeing more of it and seeing it in detail. And it made me think, okay, well, if you guys want to see the detail, I probably should take a step back and tell you a little bit more about the project before we dive into making the next series of dies out of steel. Okay, so taking that step back, if you are familiar with bullet swaging or jacket drawing, you may have heard of a company called Corbin. It's actually two Corbins, they're brothers, separate companies. The Corbin out of Oregon, I believe, is a very reputable purveyor of supplies, dies, etc. And that is where I purchased this. This is the Corbin 9mm jacket. So if you throw a pair of calipers on it, you'll see it should have about a 13 thou wall thickness. I'm getting about 14 there. And it is, I think, half an inch long. Yeah, exactly, 502. And I think it should be 352 diameter, 353. 9mm being 355. When you swage this out, what you do is you insert a swaged lead core, and then you swage this whole piece out to 355, which is a 9mm bullet's dimension. You then finally will make what you want for a bullet itself. The problem with this round is that this happens to be 115 grains. Let's grab our trusty Dillon scale here. 115.1. What's awesome is that dimension's pretty repeatable, as I've made quite a few of these. The problem is that I want 124. And the only solution for that is, unfortunately, a longer jacket. I need one longer than this half inch. The only solution from Corbin for that is to buy a 40 jacket and then buy their drawing dies and draw it down to the 353 diameter such that it'll be longer. I didn't really like that, and I thought, well, I'd been thinking about making my own dies, so now's as good a time as any. I wanted to take this chance to give a special shout out to Corbin, who has a phenomenally informative website. It's a little bit disorganized, but huge amounts of information on it, and the forum thread Cast Bullets that you can see right here. Their swaging section is the Bible, as far as I'm concerned. Been very helpful. Also, as I'm walking through this video, wanted to show off my new Manfrotto Magic Arm, which should be great for taking desk videos, gets the tripod out of my way so I can work in front of the camera a lot easier. Let's talk about the jacket blanking die for a second. It's not the first one I made. The first one I made, which I'm almost embarrassed to show, is this guy. I did this before I had my new lathe, so I machined by interpolating the circle patterns, and it didn't work. It was not very good at all. And one of the reasons that I had the wrong dimensional tolerance between the punch here and the die here, I had them almost as a press fit. And it ends up that you need couple thousandths of clearance. That whole subject introduces the concept of die making, and there are people who dedicate their whole lives to it, nearly all of whom are considerably smarter, more experienced than I am. I have read a couple books on it lately to try to bone up on it and relied on the help of others, so in no way do I want to intend like I am an expert, but what I do is kind of figure out what I need to do to get it to work. So the second one that I made was on the lathe, and the idea here was to use aluminum, which for me is more, it's easier to work, and I happen to have a fair amount of it on hand, sandwiched with a steel cutting die. And, I used the aluminum punch temporarily, thinking I could always change that to a steel rather easy, with the idea here being that your steel surface is easy to grind or sharpen, and the aluminum top part here serves really just as a guide for it. This worked okay. I was able to punch, 10 thou thick shim stock, but I didn't love it. And again, I actually had a little bit too tight of a fit. I never ended up tweaking these though, because I moved on. And the one I moved on to is this right here. And this is all steel. I turned this in the new lathe, and there's about a 4 thou difference between the OD of the punch and the ID of the die. Face it off. It's got a crisp edge, but it's not crazy sharp. It hasn't been ground. It's only off the lathe. I did polish the punch a little bit while it was still in the lathe. But the inside of this is pretty rough. I did turn a taper down from slightly below the cutting area for right here, and that's great. That lets the blanks fall through, which if you saw in the video on the first one, you did see they fall right out. What I had originally intended was for this to be run in the Corbin press, which is like a reloading press where the punch would thread in to a top ram, and that would be the alignment so that you wouldn't have had this slot right here, and rather the cutting surface or the cutting plane would have been the top here, like so. That didn't work, and so that's when I realized I had to cut this groove in here, which is really a hack job, literally and figuratively. I used a hacksaw, and it's pretty sloppy. But that let me slide the copper strips through. This one's actually a little mangled up here. It's not going to go too easily. This one should go easy. It's got a slight little bend on the end there. There we go. So, like so. But, and that works great. I was frankly shocked at how well this worked when I put it in my 12-ton shop press, and it used, I ballpark guessed the feel, 4 tons. I'm not really sure if that's accurate, just in terms of what it felt like. So that's been great, and I've cut quite a few hundred of these already just with this. The problem with it is that because I had to cut this slot with a hacksaw, the other option being a slitting saw, but two things. One, I didn't have a slitting saw that correct tolerances, and you actually do need to cut slightly on the inside that wouldn't be possible with a slitting saw. And the way I did it was I actually took the hacksaw blade apart, fed it through, reassembled the hacksaw, and finished it off by finished off the inside cut right there. Anyways, that's why I'm moving back to the sort of two-piece design here in the CAD model, where I can feed the where I can machine the strip guide nice and clean, and then I can also have access to machine or sharpen the cutting surface of the die. After I had my blanks, the first stage I made is this cupped coin, if you will, right here, and that was not with a drawing die, but rather with a simple quickly machined ring and punch. Like I said, I just centered this piece over here and pushed it down through. I did that because there's a great thread on Cast Bullets by a fellow KTN who did a similar step, so hence why I followed in his footsteps. To be honest with you, I'm not sure why, or maybe I'm misunderstanding it, because I'm not sure this step is necessary. What I will say is it only cups the material, not draw. And my understanding of the difference between those two is cupping is just folding the edges up, whereas drawing, you're doing that and you're actually thinning out the sidewalls here. Speaking of the drawing dies, the design I came up with was one I thought I could make as quickly as possible, which is this piece here. My left hand is a universal holder for all my drawing dies. This is the actual drawing die, so that has a radiused entrance mouth, if you will, which I did simply by holding my deburring tool as the part spun in the lathe slowly. That is definitely not the best way to do it. It does create some chatter along the rim, but it's quick. And then I reamed to a pretty darn close ID the diameter I wanted. I'd say I probably held, maybe half a thou, which is plenty good for what I needed. And then I made this bushing. Again, I'm sort of borrowing off of others' examples, including the folks on Cast Bullets. And what this does is it holds the previous stage piece centered, which is important. So these two sandwich together. This just serves as a holder for everything. And then the punch, I can't put the punch in because I've got the part still on the end of it from the video I made introducing this series. But that pushes through and it pushes all the way out the bottom, like here, like so. This shouldn't stick on here like it does. It does though, because there's no taper in this. So the next one I'll make, I'll probably turn a 1 or 2 degree taper on this punch, and hopefully it won't stick on there like it is right now. The next two stages up here in the right corner of your screen are progressively smaller versions of the same thing. So for example, the result of this first stage is this, which is the same as this, which fits in. there like so. That's actually kind of a snug fit. Maybe that one got dropped. And goes on top of that draw die. The last one in this example was actually even longer than this. It was almost probably a half inch or 3/8 inch longer, and it did tear a little bit around it. And it tore for, I think, a variety of reasons. I have not annealed these in between any of the drawing stages, and I think I will have to. It also suffered, as you can see, from the aluminum. The aluminum is not polished. It's not a great material for this anyways, and I'm sure seeing the aluminum streaks on here stressed or fatigued the metal and frankly added a huge amount of pressure, I'm sure, to the whole process. The last thing I wanted to talk about was the geometry of the draw die. We're starting with a piece of material that's 30 thou thick. If we want to perform a drawing operation where we end up with sidewalls that are less than 30 thou thick, that means we need to increase the diameter of the punch such that the difference between the OD of the punch and the ID of the draw die is less than that thickness. That's what forces to thin out the material. So the punch should be 550 here, and it is, and our draw die should be 600. I think it is. My calipers here might be a hair off or some dirt in the right. Well, call that 600 or close to. So that means the difference between 600 and 550 is 50 thousandths, divided by 2 is 25 thousandths. So that means we should take this material that started at 30 thousandths, and the sidewall should now be 25 thou. And sure enough, there's some burrs on this part, but you can see, there we go. 26 thou maybe, 25, 26. And that basically held true throughout the other stages of the progression, such that I can't remember now what I was shooting for here, about 15 thou, and I think I ended up at 17. Oh, no, there we go, I had 15. So we've reduced the thickness of that by half. Again, I'm new to this, but my understanding is that that's really where all the mojo is. Being able to do that and do it such that you don't tear the material, and you can do it in a reliable manner over time. I certainly have a lot of respect for the folks at Sierra and Hornady that can put out those 168 boat tails all day long and have them shoot as accurate as they do. The other point I would make is I'm starting with copper strips I bought from Corbin. I did that just because I knew that they were a quote-unquote drawing grade of copper. I'm guessing and hoping I'll find some at probably a better price or just other option vendor. And these are generic sort of one-size-fits-all material. My understanding is you can do anything up to, you know, big 45 or in 308 and even bigger rifle rounds. So the point being, if I'm trying to design a jacket that is quite small, I probably don't need to start with 1 inch wide or even 30 thou thick material. Need to do some more research and learning on that. To bring this all full circle though, the task at hand is quite simple, which is actually just to make this exact same jacketed case only 100 thou longer. So this is half an inch. I want one that's 600. That will hold enough additional lead to get me to my preferred weight of 124. The good news is, and I haven't yet proved this, but I believe you can figure out how much weight to start with simply by doing a little bit of math and realizing that if a 50 half inch long jacket weighs 16.2 grains, you can do the math and figure out how much grains you should start with. And the cool thing, I think, is that we'll take my examples here. This one weighs 51.4. The next one that was drawn down should weigh the exact same, 51.2. Sorry, scale's out of the line there. 51.2. This last one won't weigh the same because it I sheared some of the top of it off. But if we find our cup piece, it should also be 51.2-ish. There we go. Spot on the money, 51.2. So that means no matter what that just proves the obvious, which is you're not removing material, you're just moving it around. So that means I want to get to a starting disc of about 20 grains. And as you can see, these starting discs are 50 grains. So that's how I came up with my half a fat, or excuse me, half inch starting diameter versus this one, which is 0.995 for my next blanking and drawing die. That's it for today, folks. Hope again you've enjoyed. Please again let me know what questions you've got, what else you want to see, if I'm forgetting to mention stuff in the comments below. If you do like it, as always, please do me a favor and give it a thumbs up. Otherwise, see you soon. Thanks.